intentionally kept this after the lunch hour, so postprandial. Okay. So the relevance of PPG and role of premix insulin is going to be the title of the topic, and this is going to be the flow of contents, and I'll be little rushing to cover up the time. The unique characteristics of Indian phenotypes, again, risk associated with the uncontrolled PPG, insulin in the context of our country, and a last case-based discussion. So we know this START study back in 2014 has clearly shown across India, the carbohydrate consumption is more than 60%. That's the first take-home message in this slide. There's a clear non-adherence to dietary advice by the diabetic patients. This is another biggest problem we encounter in our practice. So the key realities in our country is we have high carbs, high PPG levels, and uncontrolled patients, most of them who visit us with multiple OADs, and we need a simple and convenient treatment. So can OAD basal insulin can take about all this is a big question. So we need a specific therapeutics for Indian diabetics, wherein the diet modifications most of the times will not work in spite of a repeated advice on the diet and exercise. And most of us don't emphasize or spend enough time to counsel our patients on the diet and exercise, which can bring down A1C up to tune of 2%. And no drug except insulin and GLP-1s can bring down 2%, but we don't spend enough time to emphasize on the diet and exercise. So ultimately, we all of us switch over to the drugs, multiple OADs, and insulins eventually. And this just to show you that the 7-point blood glucose profile in different populations and Indians, as seen in the mark, they show higher blood glucose after each meal compared to other regions, which compared with the West Asia, Africans, Canadians, etc. And this is again showing our own study, the relative contribution of PPG to A1C, Indians versus Caucasians. Again, we see the A1C increases with the PPG contribution in Indian context. So what are the risks with uncontrolled PPG? There are enough studies to show that the PPG and the 2-hour postprandial hyperglycemia are associated with the CVD mortality risk than FPS in Asian quads. And that's very, very important. Most of these studies, the famous study is the DECODA study. And of course, Chinese studies are enough to prove that the postprandial hyperglycemia is directly associated with the CVD mortality versus the fasting sugar in the Asian quad. That's something to be very, very important to understand. And this is, again, the postprandial hyperglycemia, the independent risk factors for macrovascular complications. Again, the DECODA and Honolulu studies are the famous ones. Just for want of time, we'll not get into these. So these hyperglycemic spikes following every meal, and most of us spend 70% in this hyperglycemic time, and they are associated with the hypercoagulability, plaque stability is reduced, fibrinolysis. You can see the N number of complications with just hyperglycemia. And of course, the carotid intima media thickness, which is one of the surrogate markers, is very clearly shown direct correlation with the postprandial hyperglycemia. And look at this study, which again clearly shows the PPG is an independent marker of mortality when you compare with the fasting glucose. And more patients achieve the target of A1C when you adhere to the PPG targets than the FBS target. This is again evidence. You can see 94% versus 64% when they adhere to the PPG target, they can well achieve the A1C. So the control of fasting sugars is necessary, but usually it is insufficient to achieve the goal of A1C, and the PPG control essential for achieving the recommended HbA1c goal in Indian context. So insulin in Indian context, of course, these are the barriers which we all of us face, and most of the patients disappear when you say you need to go on to insulin, and you need to start priming them from day one when you start them as a simple metformin or a baseline drug or even a pre-diabetic stage, that eventually in your lifetime, you are going to be an insulin. And when you start repeatedly priming your patients during each OPD visit, it's very easy to initiate insulin for them eventually, and which most of us don't do. We use it as a threat. That, okay, 3 OHAs, next time you come back, your A1C is 8.5, I'm going to start on insulin. So please do not use it as a threat. And the knowledge and education, what you have regarding insulin, you need to impart and transfer that to our patients in every visit so that it's very easy to initiate. So intensive treatment with OADs over a certain period of time has clearly shown, but eventually the glucose levels continue to steadily rise as the diabetes is a progressive disease. And in India, insulin therapy is initiated only when the A1C levels have deteriorated around 9%. To get that, the normal target, what we say, above 8.5%, above that individual target A1C, you need to initiate an insulin. But we do it around 9% in Indian context. And this insulin initiation inertia from the physicians, according to me, is more than with the patients. Because you don't educate the patients properly, obviously they have all kinds of phobias towards the insulin pricks. So this delay will eventually put our patients into all these complications. So timely initiation of insulin becomes a very, very important task in our routine clinical practice. Just to show you, 1 in 5 Indian patients in diabetes achieve A1C less than 7% with insulin therapy, which is supposed to be the gold standard eventually. 2 out of 5 patients with diabetes reduce their insulin dosage after a minor episode of hypoglycemia. Very important point. We don't again educate about hypoglycemia when we initiate insulins. We blindly initiate and send them, and no enough education again pushes them into hypoglycemia. And even 1 episode of minor hypoglycemia will make 2 out of 5 patients to withdraw from insulin. And look at the last number, 77% of the patients who experience hypoglycemia in 6 months, when you, whatever. Sorry. 77% of the patients who experience hypoglycemia in 6 months of their insulin initiation will discontinue within 1 year. And the onus is on you. So we need to be very, very cautious when we initiate and educate our patients. So look at the discontinuation rates impact. Hypoglycemia and fear of hypoglycemia will be the highest ones, which makes patients to discontinue. And this is again another study called IMPROVE. The Indian data at the time of insulin initiation, which I was alluding earlier, it takes 9% of A1C of our patients to initiate insulins in our practice. So the key realities, can a basal insulin can be suitable for all these high carb diet, and does it take care of PPG, be suitable in case of delayed insulin therapy, and offer convenience at insulin initiation with a direct total control of both FBS and PPG? Can a basal insulin do this? But this is what the recommendation says. You can say ADA, AS, IDF, etc. We'll talk about basal insulin to initiate. And the NICE guidelines talk about the premix insulin apart from basal insulin. Of course, RSSDA again talks about premix insulin also as one of the initiation choices for initiation of insulin. So I'll end with a small case, role of premix insulin in uncontrolled diabetes. You can see typically 12-year-old diabetic duration, BMI of 26. Parameters are okay, except the A1C is 9.3. FBS, PPBS, you can see 146, 255 respectively, and he's got a diabetic dyslipidemia. LFTs are okay. Blood glucose is not controlled. Look at the medications, glimepiride, sita, metformin, atorvastatin, losar, and the more number of days. In fact, there is a study which shows after 3 drugs, the adherence drops to 70%. After third drug, if you add a 4th drug, adherence, forget the efficacy, because no drug will bring down A1C of 2% or 1%, OHS, when we say. So please do not uptitrate to the maximum and try to waste time to initiate insulin. So when do you choose this premix insulin versus the basal, what most of the bodies recommend? So the glycemic factors is, if the PPBS increment is above 54, if the FPAG and HbA1c ratio is below 20, and if the difference between bedtime and morning blood glucose value is more than 55. Very simple things in your routine practice, even in the busy practice, you have to just have to calculate this and then take a call to initiate a premix. Of course, psychosocial factors, patient has got limited literacy, and simple and easy to understand regimen is needed for initiation, because you need to uptitrate, because no basal insulin with 10 units, most of our patients will not be under control. So if you choose a premix insulin where easy titration makes start at the once, and then probably you can uptitrate it to twice. And adults at early or progress stage of disease, and elderly patients in need of simple therapy. And of course, Indian realities, limited resources, simple and easy to explain insulin therapy is needed for both initiation and intensification, because we're not going to end. Again, we have inertia in uptitration of the dosage. You start with 10 or 14 units, and that guy keeps on taking it for years together, only 14 units, because it was prescribed by his physician 10 years back, 5 years back. This is what the story means. Again, hesitate, we have inertia to intensify that. And of course, being India, as I showed you one of the slides, the START study, which says 64% of the patients have hyperglycemia, I mean carbs, in their diet. So premix insulins definitely will provide control of both FBS and PPBS and convenient for initiation, uptitration, and intensification as well. Just to show you some evidence versus glargine, you can see better reduction of A1C and, of course, attaining target. The overall hypoglycemia, nocturnal hypoglycemia, again, something which we always ponder upon. So the overall hypoglycemia was also low in both groups. Nocturnal hypoglycemia was also similar in both the groups, premix versus glargine, what we are talking about. And of course, this patient was started with 10 units before breakfast. Try to find out which is the heavy meal and try to initiate dose just before that. And after 4 weeks, and another good point, what we have mentioned here, glimepiride, just try to withdraw, but uptitrate metformin 2000 mg BD, most of the patients will tolerate well. And that will also negate the so-called weight gain because of insulin. So to summarize, significant contribution from PPG, even at a higher A1C in Indian population as compared to Caucasians is seen. Premix insulins are simple to start, single injection with effective A1C control covering both FBS and PPBS. Patients uncontrolled on two or more OADs with flexible lifestyle can be started on premix insulins and dose can be titrated on a weekly basis. Again, we need to teach, educate our patients to self-titrate. SMBG is one of the easiest ones to do and the very important in our routine clinical practice. Premix insulins provide convenience, simplicity for both initiation, intensification, and premix insulins provide both convenience and efficaciousness as we saw, and it has got almost equal hypoglycemic episodes versus glargine. Thank you very much for